I'm Luke Koenig with the McCain Institute, and you're in the arena with leaders and citizens who are taking character-based action. It's an honor to be in the arena with Tamar Chugoshvili, also known as Madam Vice Speaker. She's what we would probably think of as the Deputy Speaker of the Georgian Parliament, and she's been in Washington the whole week. And you come to Washington fairly often, but this week was on a particular mission to, you tell me, but study U.S. Congress and parliamentary or congressional systems in the United States.
Well, thank you very much for having me. We have quite a large group of Georgian parliamentarians in town. The visit is supported by USAID, and it's basically an experience-sharing project. So Georgian Parliament is going through a very interesting process because Georgia is transforming itself to a parliamentary democracy, and Georgia has had a big journey on constitutional systems. So we've been we tried a super presidential system, we tried semi-presidential system, and now we are establishing ourselves as a parliamentarian democracy, which is more an European style of constitutional order.
Right.
And with that, we understand very well that we need to strengthen our legislative body. So we need to strengthen our parliament as a political center for decision-making process. And therefore, we have been implementing very crucial reforms. And the goal of this visit, the aim of this visit, was actually looking into the how Congress operates on some of the vital issues like parliamentary control and oversight, for example, the different investigations that committees conduct, budgeting process, the judicial appointments. So these are some of the things that we've been looking into during this week. We had honor and pleasure of very interesting meetings with the members, with the key staffers, with the judges, with non-state, very important non-state actors who participate in this process. And I believe that we are going back understanding much better what are the good things, actually, that we can share from this experience. And right as we go back, we have to make some of the big decisions in Georgian Parliament on appointing the Supreme Court justices, which is a key process for us. So we've been looking into a very, very details how this judicial nomination and appointment process works here. And I believe that this was very interesting across the board for opposition, for majority members, for everyone basically who participates in this process in Georgian Parliament.
So you're very much involved in building the systems associated with the parliament in Georgia. I think for someone like me, I can get a little too focused at times on Congress in the United States and what doesn't seem to work or where there are divisions, and you forget about the systems and things that are in place that I suppose as an American you could perhaps take for granted if you're not careful. I saw on your agenda you visited things like the Congressional Research Service.
Indeed.
And I suppose those are the sort of decisions and things you have to think about in your country as you take this forward.
Well, yes, indeed. So what I would really envy to the members of Congress is a very good, solid, professional information that they receive from the neutral sources, which is Congressional Research Services, which is Budget Office, which is Government Accountability Office. So these kind of institutions who provide very qualified, very good source of information, independent source of information that helps committees and helps the members to make their decisions on investigations, on legislating. So we are, we started several years ago several processes simultaneously. So one was establishing the proper legislation, so creating the legal basis for the parliament to be strong and to be able to control government and hold government accountable. And at the same time, we started reforming our internal capacities, like creating the resource which is key for the parliamentarians to be well-informed and to have some credible information for in the decision-making process. So we are setting up the parliamentary research services, and in that process we've been collaborating with the congressional research services, because this is one of the best established institutions across the world. Wherever you go, I have seen many parliaments, many research services, and
right.
I know the ones which are very good and ones which are like not that good. And congressional research services looks like is very beneficial. All members appreciate the support that they are receiving from this office. And we are also looking forward for creating the institutional strengths in our parliament, because politicians come and go, but then there are civil servants who stay there,
right,
and who work for the sake of institution, its credibility, its professionalism, and establishing this part of the parliament in a way that it has to be established is very, very important. So in some sense, we are establishing the precedents. We are creating the mechanisms that will be useful for generations of parliamentarians to come. This is how we see it. And one of the very interesting observation that we are taking back home is that there is a huge difference in how things work here and how things work in Georgia. And basically, this difference is that a lot in U.S. Depends on political process, norms and practices and history that has been established throughout years and decades and centuries. Because U.S. has centuries of history of democratic rule.
Right.
And as my country has had a chance to regain its independence only 3 decades ago, and we are a young democracy still who is trying to establish everything that you already have for quite a long time, we depend much more on rules, on procedures, on literally what is written in the law rather than the history and practices, because we do not have
the kind of legislative norms or...
Yes. So we are very much into procedures, like we are very much into what our procedures say. And here it is more what is the practice and what is the negotiation between the political groups, what are the precedents. And that makes difference, of course. These precedents change with the different political contexts. Decisions are made in a different way. Sometimes there is no big consistency, but it is very interesting to observe how this political dynamics is vibrant and how that affects the outcomes of the decision-making process. In our case, we believe that good laws are very, very important, because the good laws are the ones which should create the good precedents, actually, and with the time get Georgia to the point when it's less about like hundreds of pages of procedures and more about the political culture and how parties manage to cooperate across the board.
Well, you're at the center of this, and taking a step back, I mean, anyone who listens to you and sees you in action can tell that you're a serious legislator and leader. How did you get there? How did you get inspired to be in politics and service? And then tell us a little bit about your path that has you in this role.
Well, my main background is with the civil society organization. So after the college I started, I joined a very impressive group of young lawyers. It is in Georgia, it is called Young Lawyers Association. And back then when I graduated my school, Georgia was still a very corrupt place. It is one of the least corrupt countries in the world right now, but back then it was very, very different. Georgia managed to go through very impressive anti-corruption, good governance reforms throughout the years. And back then, basically every place where young student or a young graduate could go would meet very corrupt institutions. And I did not want to go there. And the best place to go, actually, which was very, very different from everything that we were used to see, was the Georgian Young Lawyers Association. And this place gave me this passion to care for how institutions operate and how decisions are made and what kind of laws does country have. And for 8 years, I worked there in different capacities. I had been heavily involved with the Georgian Parliament, so I developed this big interest for the legislature and lawmaking process. And actually, the turn for me, the crucial moment was related to the United States, actually, because about 11 years ago, I participated in a wonderful program that U.S. government was offering. It was called Legislative Fellows Program. Hmm. And I was based in the Law Library of Congress as an intern, actually, for several months internship. And recently, I found my motivation letter when I was writing my, submitting my papers for this program. And I did not even remember.
It must have been a good one.
I did not even remember, but the things I was writing there 11 years ago was that I care about the institutional reforms in Georgian Parliament, and in 10 years, I see myself as a member. So like, I would not,
that's a good one.
I would not predict back then that it would be exactly what I would be doing in 10 years, but it turned out that I decided to run for the office. I was elected as the first vice speaker of the parliament. We have just one chamber. We do not have two. So this is unicameral parliament. And it gave me an amazing opportunity to work on things that I really care about. I think that the legislature, the parliament, is the key for Georgia's future democratic progress. So I think that it is vital to have good dynamics in the parliament. And at the same time, I care about the women's rights, and I also work a lot on gender equality issues. We have the very low women's political participation.
That's what it was. What's 15% in parliament? Is that still about right? And a little bit lower than that in local? And
exactly. This is correct. And this number is the historical maximum that we have ever had, because we had 6 and we have 9 and 12, and now we have 15% representation, which is still very, very small representation of women. While a century ago, 100 years ago, when Georgia has established, before Soviet occupation, when Georgia has established its first democratic state, we not only had the rights for women, but we had women in parliament. So we had women parliamentarians who
And is that right?
Exactly, 100 years ago. So so the Soviet occupation had many bad things that it brought, including changing how women are seen and how women are like perceived in for the public office or for the parliament. And we are now starting from the beginning, actually, and now we are trying to encourage women to be more active, because Georgia has amazing women in civil society in different places who are very active, who are very professional, who have amazing academic.
I've seen some of that firsthand or experienced that, because we work together with a partner in Georgia for our Tbilisi conference, and you see that. So you'd like to see it go from what, 15% to 50% or and more? Or
well, the 50% would be a good one.
Right.
So hopefully in the nearest future, we will manage to get to 30% women representation. So this is the minimum that that might be acceptable. Well, 15% cannot be acceptable. So 30 is something that we can live with. So, and we are advocating, well, Georgia is making a big progress on women's issues. Like, for example, on domestic violence, we have had transformational changes. We have recently passed legislation, sexual harassment, which is working very, very well. We are now working on women's economic empowerment. So there are like very dynamic things that are happening in Georgia in terms of women's rights. But in addition to that, we are advocating for mandatory gender quotas, so which obviously has a lot of opponents. So there are a lot of people who have arguments against it, but then we also have quite good arguments in favor of it. So hopefully, I think that if this parliament, we have the 9th convocation of parliament in Georgia, and this parliament has already made very memorable, crucial decisions, like very important constitutional amendments, very important internal reforms. And one additional thing that this parliament can do, actually, to stay in the history would be to vote for the mandatory gender quotas, which would ensure at least 30% representation for women in politics.
And I want to talk more about Georgia right now, but one more kind of question, I guess, from the past, although the legacy to me sure seems present. Senator John McCain, I don't know if when you were over at the Library of Congress, but it, you know, his intersection with Georgia sure seems like a big deal, at least to us at the McCain Institute and to a lot of those here. But and so can you speak to that a little bit?
Well, yeah, I think he was a person who cannot be substituted in Georgia-U.S. relationships by anyone. So he was seen from Georgia as the biggest supporter, someone who cared, someone who loved the country. His staff was telling me that every time he was getting on the plane, he was asking his staff, like, on the way, can we get to Georgia? Like,
right.
Wherever he was traveling on
can
the way.
Can he work in a stop, yeah.
Like, we are going to completely different direction. Like, we can
going to Asia,
stop, like,
but can we stop
can
in
we,
Georgia?
Can we stop there on the way back? Right, like, right. Is it possible? No, we are going to a completely different direction. So he was with us during very hard times, difficult times. Georgia has always felt his support, and not only support, but this very genuine love for the country. And we appreciated that very much. And him passing away was a big loss, I believe, for everyone in the country, because he was very much loved and appreciated.
Well, I see this week, if I have it right, there's an act, the Support Georgia mm-hmm. Act. And I want to ask you about, I was captivated by something I saw seeing you, some of your speeches, and you're active, you're out there speaking a lot. Georgia as a gateway country. Mm-hmm. In our country, I think you hear people talk about St. Louis and the Arch, and St. Louis as a gateway to the mm-hmm. inner part of the country. You talk about Georgia as a gateway country to the region.
We have we are located in a very challenging region. So we are under between Russia, Turkey, Iran, very close.
Right.
And obviously, this is a very challenging geography on one hand, but on the other hand, there is an entry point to a very, very important region. And Georgia has been the only and very loyal partner to United States throughout these years. So our ambition is that in our neighborhood, basically, nobody has really as strong ambition to be a democratic state. We do have that, while being a very small country under big challenges. And
you face kind of a persistent threat, I would say, right?
We do. 20% of our territories is occupied by Russia. These threats are permanently there. But despite that, Georgia managed to maintain, with the support of the friends, like United States, Georgia managed to maintain its sovereignty, its independence, and is striving for developing as a true democratic country, aspiring to become the member of European Union and the NATO. And this location, as much as it is a challenge for us, it is also a great opportunity for our partners, because in that location, in that place, having a country which throughout, since regaining independence under different governments, has been a very, very good friend, very loyal partner, and has been increasingly good relationships with the United States and European countries and all democratic world. We see this also as a good opportunity for seeing the mutual benefits in helping each other and in supporting each other. And
I guess NATO
have,
or...
Yes, well, we have very good cooperation. Well, Georgia is, it is often stated that Georgia has never been so close to NATO membership. Still, it's not obvious when the decision will be made. We know that Georgia will become the member. It has been stated by NATO, but we do not know when. Though we have, and we do have a very intense, very good cooperation with the U.S. on defense, on economic front, on democracy issues, on so many, so many topics. And I believe that this cooperation is obviously good for our country, but it's also good for the United States, because it empowers the good partner and a friend who might be very important in some context and in some situations.
I'm putting you on the spot here a little bit, I suppose, but kind of two questions. One, you know, how broadly have you traveled in the United States? I know you've been to the United States a lot, but have you kind of been to the heartlands? And then what would you say to Americans thinking about traveling to Georgia? I've become a fan of Georgia wine, you know, and would love to go see the wine lands in Georgia and to go to Tbilisi. But kind of two questions. One, how much have you traveled in the U.S.? And then how should Americans think about Georgia and traveling there?
Well, I traveled quite a lot in the United States. I lived for some time here also, so mainly East Coast and Mid States,
right.
Less the West Coast. And what would I say? I think that it is an Georgia is, and I'm biased, of course, but I
right.
think that very good, amazing touristic destination, first of all, because this is in a very small territory, there are such a diversity of things that people can experience, you know, so seasides and hiking places and mountains and desert and basically everything. And there is an amazing food and wine and very good people who are very hospitable and who are honored to receive guests. And Georgia is among one of the most safest countries. Despite the challenges that I spoke, it's a very, very safe country. And there is, I believe everybody who has come at least once had the feeling to come back because I think this place makes you feel very, very good there. And there is some good spirit, actually, that people usually feel. So I would very much encourage, though it's a long distance and
right.
long flights, but it's worth it.
Kind of a standard last question, advice to the next generation or, you know, maybe women in particular, but who want to get in the arena, be in public service, be a parliamentarian, be a legislator. What's your advice?
Well, my advice is to not shy away from having this ambition to participate in the process which affects our lives and our children and our families. And women in politics have to experience many bad things, sometimes things that our male colleagues do not have to experience that.
You mean discrimination or?
Discrimination, bullying, especially cyberbullying,
yep.
like the attempts to be not to be heard, you know, not to be taken seriously. I think that I do not think I actually it's a fact actually that politics becomes much more mature when there is an equal representation of both genders and women play very different role and unique and important role in this politics. It does not mean that it should be women's domination. No, it should be equality, like societies, half men, half women, and the decision-making process should work in the same way. And I believe that we who are women who have been prior to us, and we are also paving the way for the women to come. And we are doing our best to make life easier for those women who will come after us, actually, and to establish some practices, establish some culture that won't make women after us to experience the same challenges that we have to experience. And I believe that there are a lot of amazing women in our country who have the very good potential to work for the sake of the country, to serve the country and Georgian people. And I believe that with some additional courage, we will get this big transition in Georgian politics. And we are trying to create this sentiment and this environment in our country. And we see more and more women coming. And I believe that this is a good dynamic. And I'm very optimistic about the future.
Courage and character go a long ways. And it seems like you have it in spades. And Georgia has shown it. Final last question. What's next for you?
Well, I wish I knew. I wish I knew that. I actually have to sit down and write my next motivation.
Right, right.
Letter,
yes,
you know?
Yes.
So, and in 10 years, I will show you what will be in the letter because it's difficult. At this stage, I believe that it has been only 2 years and a half for me in the parliament.
Right.
I believe that there is a lot to do there still. So for some time, I think that I will stick to that because I still see potential in myself actually to work on very, very good things, some very important reforms, changes that actually are very exciting for me also, and I believe they are in a great benefit of the country. So I believe that despite sometimes being tired and exhausted, I feel the enough motivation in myself actually to stick to that for some time, but it's difficult for me to say what will be in 10, 15 years.
That'll be a neat letter to go back and read. I hope we get the chance to do that. Madam Vice Speaker, thank you so much for being
thank
in
you
the
so
arena.
Much.
This podcast is produced by Patrick McCann and Justin Kessler. If you like what you hear, please subscribe, tell your friends, or leave a review.